whether this is pandemic, global warming, population growth, space exploration, or others, we face many challenges today. A key tool in such domains is to use computer resources. In fact, anyone with programming abilities can develop a program to help solve problems with its own computer. Others can then use the same program to solve their own related issue. There are three important areas of solutions today that rely on computer resources. They are called HPC, HPDA, and AI. HPC, or high performance computing, encompasses techniques that allow running complex calculations at high speed. HPDA, or high performance data analysis, are the set of techniques to process huge amounts of data to get useful information out of them. Finally, AI, or artificial intelligence, is the study of systems that perceive their environment and take action that maximize their chance of achieving their goals. If this is a small problem, a single computer is obviously enough. For example, laptops, desktops, and even mobile phones are powerful enough today to surf the internet, play music, or run video games, usually at the same time. But of course, if the size of the problem increases, so does its running time. A good idea to overcome this issue is to share the work between multiple cores and computers. For certain problems, it is indeed possible to split the workload between different computers, which run at the same time. This is called parallelization, and it can boost a project by drastically reducing the overall time. To do so, the program needs to be written using specific libraries, such as OpenMP, MPI, or others. But don't worry, many scientific programs already have those, so one just needs to run the software with the good setup. Of course, if those computers are dedicated to calculation, they do not need to play music or to display anything. Usual computers are not the best choice. Only the useful pieces are kept: a compute unit called CPU, some memory, storage, communication interfaces, some cooling, and that's it. This is a computer node. And when different computer nodes are stacked together, well, one basically gets a supercomputer. Is that enough? Actually, no. To be efficient, a given node needs to speak to all others, so a supercomputer needs a fast and dedicated network. Therefore, this is also called a cluster. To store and request shared information, a common storage is also required, which can be accessed by all the nodes. And something else worth mentioning: pieces of hardware called accelerator that help to run software. An interesting example is the graphical cards, or GPUs. Even though they are generally used to display things, the huge computing power that is available to run AAA video games can also be exploited to solve other problems as well, with good performances. Everything is packed into cabinets, and altogether, this forms the supercomputer. But it does not have an interface that one can directly access. A user who needs to get into the cluster must do it from its own computer. It will use a secured protocol called SSH so that nobody can steal information. Truth is, it can interact with the supercomputer, but using commands. Indeed, there is generally no graphical interface. One needs to learn a few Unix commands to interact with the supercomputer. Don't worry, it's not that difficult, and there are many resources and trainings available. Of course, one user cannot get the whole cluster to itself. There are other people that would like to get a piece of that cake too. Thus, computer power should be shared between the different users. In order to do that, each time someone wants to perform a calculation, it needs to submit a job to the scheduler, which is a program that runs continuously on the cluster. For each job, a user needs to request the resources the job will need, such as the memory, the number of CPU, the running time, and others. Then, the scheduler takes the request and puts it in the job queue in a waiting or pending state. The user can leave and come back later. When submitted, a job remains on the supercomputer, even if the user logs out. Then, every time there is a slot available, the scheduler looks for the best job to use it. But users need to be careful. If a job uses more than the resources that were requested, it gets killed. That's hard, but that is the only way to share the supercomputer fairly between all users. Fortunately, there are many supercomputers that one can use. According to the PRIS partnership, they are divided in three categories: The first one, the Tier 2, is dedicated to locally managed supercomputers such as university clusters. Then, Tier 1 is the category for nationally managed supercomputer. Finally, the Tier 0 category contains the European clusters. Generally, a change of category is accompanied by a boost of computational performances. Those are measured in floating point operations per second, or FLOPS. Of course, the higher the number of operations, the faster the whole calculation will be. At the Belgian level, there are multiple Tier 2 clusters. In Wallonia, there is one for each university: Namur, Liège, Mons, Bruxelles and Louvain-la-Neuve. They are all managed under a common consortium, the Consortium des Equipements de Calcul Intensif, or CC in short. Same goes for the Flemish side, so Leuven together with Hasselt, Antwerp, Ghent and again Brussels, which are all managed by the Vlaams Supercomputer Centrum, or VSC. Both VSC and CC provide access, support and training for their respective supercomputers. There are also two Tier 1 clusters in Belgium. Zenob is in Wallonia and managed by Senaro in collaboration with the CC, while Brainiac and Hortons are in Flanders and managed by the VSC. Each of them has the capacity to perform to at least 500 teraflops. As of 2021, there are, at the European level, 7 Tier 0 supercomputers that are accessible, managed by the PRIS partnership. This organism is composed of 26 members, including countries outside of the European Union. It manages the access to the 7 clusters which perform in the petaflop regime. The PRIS partnership also regularly proposes training sessions, so don't forget to check their website pris-ri.eu if you are interested. Since 2018, the EUHPC joint undertaking has taken the lead concerning the HPC policy in Europe. They have proposed and implemented the eurocc project, which asks to each country to implement a national computer center, or NCC. Its goal is to foster activities in the HPC, HPDA and AI fields and serve as a contact point for academics, industrial or public administrations. At the Belgian level, both the VSC and the CC are part of the NCC, together with Innovis for the Brussels region and Scenario for the coordination. The EUHPC initiative also co-funded the construction of the latest European supercomputer, called Lumi, and located in Finland. The Lumi consortium is composed of 10 countries, including Belgium. This new cluster is expected to reach 550 petaflops, making it one of the fastest supercomputers in the world as of 2021. Large parts of its performances will come from GPUs. Lumi is also only using energy coming from hydropower for a greener future. For more information, check their website lumi-supercomputer.eu. So, by exploiting the capacity of software to run in parallel on supercomputer, users are now able to solve complex problems in a minimum of time. Many supercomputers are available for the willing users, and using them is not difficult if one speaks their language. What are you waiting for?